For Kramamedia's Polity, I'm Sane Dlamini, founder and the leader of Al Jama-ah, is in conversation with Polity about the party manifesto. So, Mr. Hendricks, you say that your party should be viewed as the party for all communities. What is the mission of your party?
Look, most parties are formed in a temple or a church, and our party was formed in a mosque. The ANC was formed in the Regina Church in Soweto. So you find that parties establish themselves in a church to try and get the first seat and get some support, and the congregation knows them and will vote for them. But the Muslim community in South Africa is a very small community, 1 or 2%. There's no way that we can make an impact just depending on Muslim voters. Most of them will unfortunately vote for the DA. So it's quite a problem for us. And so once we got our first seat, we changed our position to be a platform for all communities. The first people who joined our platform were 15,000 Zulus in Escort. They didn't pay their deposit. We told them, vote for us, we'll give you the seats that you acquired with your vote, and we did so for 5 years. So now we have a memorandum of agreements with the Khoi, and we also have a separate memorandum of agreement with the San. Our mayor in Nelson Mandela Bay is from the Khoi. We slaughtered a bull because we wanted to put a bull in that municipality to shake it up in Port Elizabeth. And we did the same. We also slaughtered a bull for Harding, where we have the ANC, for example, has all the councillor seats. Mm-hmm. And we are ready to win all 11 seats. And that's why they send in the president, they send in all the heavyweights. So you can see that we are a platform for all communities. The president of our Women's League is Willy Letuli, the daughter-in-law of Chief Albert Letuli. She's the president of our Women's League. We have 12,000 wards we are contesting, and nearly 60% of people outside our faith. So we're not a religious party. We are a political party, and while our ethos is Islam, as you know that in this month our Prophet was born, and he went to Medina and established the first municipality in the world, and he set policies and bylaws and projects that we are now emulating all over South Africa. We're contesting 31 municipalities. We are co-governing in Escort. We are co-governing in the city of Johannesburg. We don't form coalitions. We co-govern. And when we're given a mayoral committee seat, we don't want gatekeepers. We run it on the merits. And at the moment, for example, you will find that we have such a seat, Councillor Tapelo Ahmed from Soweto. He represents the party. And he set the standards on what a mayoral committee member should do. The same in Lanesia award we won from the DA and the ANC. Our councillor there is setting the standards on how a ward councillor should work. So that's why they call him the beloved councillor, the only beloved councillor in South Africa. That's Imran Wursa. So Al Jama-ah, we are creating waves in the Free State. Two of our mayoral candidates are young female African girls from two TFET colleges. One is in the health sector and the other one is in the engineering sector. So we want to encourage young people to take part in the political life of the country. And we will mentor them. You may say, now, how can you put a young girl of 22 into a mayoral seat? No, we have a backup team. And, you know, we will train them. We have young people in parliament. We have young people in the provincial legislatures. Why can't we have young people in municipalities? So we are a platform for all communities, and we are a platform for the youth. Like I said, in the Free State, 90% of our candidates are black females. I think that's a higher percentage of everyone. That is in Bethlehem, for example. And I must get used to these municipalities that we were co-governed. I must write all the names on my wall so that I can remember them. Because so far we've only in 3 or 4 municipalities, and now we are in 31 municipalities.
Some will argue that while your party was formed in 2007, although you do have ward councillors and you are represented in the national parliament as well as the Western Cape legislature, your party has not been successful in attracting enough voters to run municipalities. How would you respond to that?
Well, we're co-governing one of the biggest municipalities in the country, that's the city of Johannesburg. We're in charge of planning. No other mayoral candidate can do their work unless it's passed via our desk. We've had major achievements that our party, directed our councillor to tackle, and he's made a name for himself. You'll see all his billboards all over Johannesburg. The corporate world loves him. They want him to continue. They're supporting his campaign, and communities are supporting their campaign. So yes, we started as a small party. Like I said, the Muslim community is just 1 or 2%. We are a Muslim party, but a platform for all communities. Every election, we double our votes. So we hope to garner 200,000 votes this time. And we want to co-govern 5 municipalities. Nelson Mandela Bay, the city of Johannesburg, which we're already co-governing, Escort, which we're already co-governing, and Swani. And the 5th municipality, we're not going to co-govern. We're going to take over the whole of Harding. The elders in Harding, very loyal supporters of the liberation movement. They have been let down for 27 years. We presented our position to them. They're very happy. And they want the Al-Jama'ah to run the entire municipality so that they can enjoy the benefits of the liberation that they fought for. Harding had no water for 3 years. And our mayoral candidate, he managed to put in 10 boreholes, and the town now has water. So, when we slaughtered a bull and we did our campaign, the governing party sent Minister Munshi with 40 cars to disrupt us. They only had 5 people walking behind them. The mayor then bought a fire engine. President Sarmapose had a garden tea party for them. But that municipality we're going to take. So we'll just watch the space.
Now, Mr. Hendricks, South Africans are complaining about the level of crime and the slow pace in service delivery issues like water and better roads. Does your party have a solution to these issues?
Look, when it comes to service delivery issues, the main problem we see is sewage pollution. It is not acceptable that after 27 years, the African child must live in sewerage, must eat in sewerage, must learn in sewerage, must play in sewerage. So we have been very active with regard to sewage pollution. You see there, once you pull the chain, it goes to a treatment plant. And they poorly treat that water and they pour it in the waterways. And as it goes along, it harms the livestock. It harms the horses, it harms the people, and when it gets into the ocean, it harms the fish. That's why Cape Town is famous for its snook. Half of our snook are diseased if you examine it. So it's a big problem. So we have taken the governing party in the city of Cape Town, that's the Democratic Alliance, we've taken them on as a model for the rest of the country, and we're going to now use that model to solve South Africa's sewage crisis. So we got 3 awards from the Director of Environment Enforcement. We had a settlement agreement with the public protector who sat down, Patricia de Lille, and told her, this place, Masipumalele, the conditions here is the worst I've seen in my life. And we got the Human Rights Commissioner to do a damning report. So there's been some improvement. The National Management Environment Act provides that officials will do this. Must go to jail for 10 years, and they can be fined 10 million rand. So we are going to go from municipality to municipality and jail officials who want to kill our children. With regard to water, We are very active, and the NGOs that we are associated with, all of them are trying to raise funds for boreholes. We have fundraising efforts. Like in Harding, we put up several boreholes, and the first time people had water, the municipality still hasn't done enough. We even spoke to the King of Saudi Arabia, the diplomatic people here, and asked them to build more dams for us. And we told them, we'll name it after you and you'll be famous. I don't care if they are famous, as long as we have dams for water. We've identified a few strategic places where we can build these dams, especially in Cape Town, where the DA concocted the Day Zero. They paid R1 billion for research by consultants. And the consultants said that as we speak now, the dams will be empty. Just come and visit our dams, 90% full. Cape Town can supply water to other provinces. So what other parties do, they create a crisis, they try and solve it and say, yes, we solved the water crisis. But in the meantime, their consultants, get R1 billion and siphon off money to their party funds. We are not that kind of a party. We cut our suit according to our cloth. And that's why we're contesting 7 provinces, 31 municipalities, 1,200 wards, and we will next time do better. And then Limpopo and Mpumalanga, watch out, we're coming for you in 2024. People are saying, why is Al-Jama'ah not there? The Al-Jama'ah has captured the imagination of young people because we provide opportunities for them to be councillors, to be MPLs, and to be MPs. We don't kill one another for positions. There's enough positions available. You know, we only 10% of the positions are available in contesting. So other parties like the EFF and the ANC and even the DA, they kill one another for seats. We've got enough seats, so people must come forward. There's a place for them in Al-Jama'ah.
You also promised to end evictions. Would you mind unpacking how this can help many South Africans who have fallen victim to evictions?
Look, you find that in the city of Cape Town, there are bylaws that, for example, don't allow people even to sleep in the street. Then you are charged and arrested, and you got to pay a fine. Now, bylaws can't trump constitutional rights. And so we have like a police state in the city of Cape Town. That's why they want the army. They want to control the army. They want their own army. They want to break away and form a white city of Cape Town. They want to form a white province. They want to break away from Africa, be their own country. And that can't be. The Freedom Front Plus supports it. Most of the DA support it, except the Premier. So, you know, he understands that you can't swear allegiance to the Constitution and then the national anthem, which says, we for you, South Africa. We don't see we for you, South Africa, except Cape Town and KwaZulu-Natal. We say we for South Africa. And we fought many years to unite South Africa. And now you have the white conglomerates, co-opting coloreds and Indians to support their whites. To break away from the country. That's treason. Those people, if we die the death penalty, they should be hanged. No country will allow people to secede and take away territories. They fight for last inch of territory. Here in the city in Cape Town and Western Cape, they talk about self-determination. Just imagine the international criteria for self-determination is you must have the same language and the same culture. In Cape Town, there are 100 different languages. Even Afrikaans, there are 5 ways of speaking it. And those 5 communities don't talk to one another. They hate one another. They don't associate with one another. They don't marry one another. They don't play much sports with one another. So there's no cultural cohesion as far as culture and language is concerned. So there's a fake premise that, yes, we can ask for self-determination. But in Cape Town, we are too diverse. It's impossible. We have a very moderate approach. We feel in coming up, we come up with constructive solutions. We don't do service delivery. Service delivery is a swear word. Any party which says, yes, we're the champions of service delivery, You need to sit with people and tell them, look, what do you want us to do? You don't adopt a policy, an ANC policy, a DA policy, then get a budget and then implement it. No way is you go to the people in your voting station, in your ward, and you ask them, now what can we do? And then you formulate your budget and you do projects where they do. And every ward must have its own budget. You can't get money out of the pool because in the Cape Town, the deputy mayor controls the finances. He decides, you know, where to put money. And if there's a flashpoint, you quickly divert some money there. And now the new mayoral candidate for the city of Cape Town is a financial colleague of mine, an honorable colleague of mine from Parliament. He's the financial spokesman for the DA. You can imagine how financial apartheid will increase here in the city of Cape Town. And coming back to the evictions, there's no way someone must be evicted from a house without getting alternative accommodation. That is a ruling of the Constitutional Court. So now the DA has bylaws, and these bylaws they think can trump the Constitution. A High Court just ruled last week, a High Court judge said, you know, what is this? Is this a kangaroo municipality? Is the city of Cape Town a police state or a police city? And you go around giving fines to people who sleep on the street? And the judge made it clear people won't do that if they were not desperate. They don't do it because they want to have fun and enjoy themselves. They're desperate. They suffer the cold during the night. As far as housing is concerned, the city of Cape Town, where I am, and other parts of the country, they return their budgets to the Treasury because they just don't make the cut to build houses. So our policy is state land must be confiscated without compensation. Now, there's a lot of state land which is owned by different entities, the Army, the Navy, the NEL, and transport, and so many. And this land is vacant now for 50 years, and nothing has been done on it, and they don't need it. So when I got a petition from 500 sailors from Simonstown Naval Base to help them, I raised it in Parliament, and we confiscated the Navy land and gave it to their cooperative without compensation. So Altima is the first party that has confiscated land without compensation and transferred it to a cooperative that will benefit sailors. So now they can put up their houses because the land is free. You know, land is very expensive in these white areas, these beachy areas, these leafy areas. But once you've got the land, you will be creative and put up a top structure. So that's what we want to do throughout the country. And I was in the East, in Nelson Mandela Bay 2 days ago. We started a book, and I told the people that South End, which was where people were forcibly removed, we will have densification in those white areas with big parks, and we'll have high-rise buildings and bring the people back to where they were forcibly removed. The whites can stay there. We don't have a quarrel with that. We will push densification as a policy, and we will ask Singapore to assist us with high-rise buildings. I'm meeting ambassadors from all over. We want to bring tourism to South Africa, and the Indonesian ambassador has said, I have 10 million tourists that want to visit South Africa. Just make sure they get their visa on arrival. So I spoke to the minister, Minister Latuli. She said, I will get you the visas on arrival. Bring us the tourists. Kazakhstan told the president Ramaphosa, we are offering our services. We are the fourth best agricultural country in the world. Al-Jama'ah is taking that up, and we promised the Eastern Cape that we'll get the assistance of Kazakhstan. Eastern Cape becomes a breadbasket of South Africa and the breadbasket of Africa. There's land there, the land is fertile. You just put the seed into the ground and the next day you have a tree. So we want to exploit those opportunities in the Eastern Cape. So Al-Jama'ah, you see the Department of National Interest, they got no time for other countries. They buy property in the cloud and pay for it, and their land doesn't exist, for example, in New York. So there's corruption. They steal the money, they loot. The top four people have been fired. The poor minister doesn't want to know what to do. the Department of International Relations must be the worst department of all government departments. So how can you build the relations with other countries, over 200, that wants to help South Africa, that wants to add value? The Minister of Trade and Industry has no time to see the ambassador of Pakistan. Not interested. But if you tell them, yes, this is your cut, and which people must we speak to, then they cooperate. If you want a straightforward meeting with ambassadors, forget about it. You've got to come via four people so each of them can get a cut. Some of our ministers, they just don't make the cut. President Ramaphosa is picking the wrong ministers. And that's why so many of them, even the Minister of Health, had to step aside. President Ramaphosa doesn't know how to choose ministers. He must do a course in recruitment. He needs to have KPAs. He needs to be personally involved before he recruits a minister. Yes, so he's a hopeless president because he picks hopeless ministers, deputy ministers, director generals. A dozen director generals have to go. Even judges. We have judges that don't understand Ubuntu, that don't understand African jurisprudence, and they want to sit on the bench. Well, they want to implement European values. So now you know where Al-Jama'ah comes from. We feel that this is what South Africa wants, and that's why so many people are now voting for our party.
And now many parties have been promising to end load shedding, but it was interesting to read in your manifesto that you are promising a reduction in the high cost of electricity. Would you please share your plan with us?
Yes, the reason why we have to reduce the cost of electricity, because every day shacks are burned down because of candles, paraffin, and people are dying, and children and women are dying. And we feel that the municipality has to subsidize dramatically the cost of electricity, and that no one's light must be cut off if they can't afford to pay. So if there's unemployment, the municipality has been given by National Treasury EPWP jobs and grants. Tell the people, okay, we won't cut your electricity, but come and work for 1 week and come mow the lawn. And that money will be able to pay your arrears. No, they cut the electricity, they cut the water. Now, Al-Jama'ah's position is that the constitution has failed us. That Cyril Ramaphosa, who was, and those who were involved in drawing up the constitution, they ignored the poor people. And what did they say in the constitution? Access to water, access to electricity, access to housing. No. Al-Jama'ah position is there must be a right to water. There must be a right to electricity. So municipalities who have the mandate to look after service delivery, they have to make sure that people always have water, always have lights, no matter what the cost. So there's a fault with the constitution, and every year there's an opportunity for members of parliament to make amendments to the constitution. I was on the ad hoc committee for Amendment 18 on land reform, and we made some recommendations that was accepted. The 19th Amendment, we are going to push for a right to water and a right to electricity. I can't wait for that opportunity.
And would you mind sharing with us, Mr. Hendricks, the criteria that you use in choosing your representatives in the municipalities and in communities to make sure that there is no corruption?
Look, we haven't had any corruption so far, so the methods that we use seems to work. I was one of the top guns in the corporate world when it comes to executive search and recruitment. So I use my experience I had with Naspers and with Nestle as the chief of recruitment. And I use that expertise. And then, we are a bit soft on women counselors. They don't have lots of opportunities. And then we depend on the IEC to do their work and identify people who have criminal records. The IEC's responsibility is to make sure that those who are elected councillors are not crooks that they don't have jail records, and then they need to turn down the application. But they issue certificates left, right, and center. The IEC has issued certificates to contest to thousands of people over the years who are crooks. So they're not doing their job properly. They're not carrying out their mandate. So political parties will have to spend more time on that. And we lucky so far. But now with the 1,200 candidates, and if they all win their seats and we've got 1,200 wards, I'm sure that some of them will be corrupt, but we will deal with them harshly.
That was Mr. Hendricks in conversation with Polity about the Al-Jama'ah manifesto.